Today we'll be reviewing an epic hand from the shit show known as High Stakes Poker, where shadowy figures from the underworld gather to launder their money. In this installment, this game featured Doug Polk and six homeless people pulled off the street. So Phil opens it up in the hijack with Queen 10 off, which likely is at the bottom of range for a gigantic nit. The action folds around to Fred Flintstone on the button. He calls with deuces and then it folds to Doug, who has 10-7 off in the big blind. So even though Doug is getting good odds, with the early nit raiser and button cold caller, you would think that Doug should be playing relatively tight here. These guys are very deep, which generally means that the value of position increases significantly. Also, implied odds become magnified when the SPR is higher, which does not bode well for a combo that's very likely to make a weak, dominated hand, but not much else. So in theory, this is a clear fold. But on the other hand, when you get the chance to play a pot against Phil Hellmuth, sometimes you need to just sacrifice your principles and throw reason out the window, and so Doug puts in the call. The flop comes Jack-9-8, Doug checks it over to Phil, which is standard, and Phil has a decision of whether to bet or slow play. Now, according to the solver, either option is fine, but of course, Phil doesn't subscribe to this new age fad known as math and probabilities, and instead he avails to a source of far greater reliability, white magic. And so, with an immaculate read, he checks it over to Fred, who takes a stab with his twos, which is actually solver approved. His hand doesn't really want to see other streets, and is happy to try to take it down, following the passive actions of his two opponents. Facing Fred's bet, Doug decides to spring his trap, raising it just under 4x, and we see that in this spot, the solver mirrors Doug's strategic philosophy, where all options are fine, and so your choice ultimately has no meaning. And with the action back to Phil, he has a very interesting decision. On the one hand, he's holding the nuts, and a raise could scare one or both of his opponents away. On the other hand, there's a flush draw on the board, and there's also the strong possibility that one or both of his opponents are holding a set or two pair that could improve to a full house. Surprisingly, the solver shoves this particular combo with the backdoor flush draw 98% of the time. However, the overall range is only shoving 0.8% of the time, and so it's highly unlikely there's a GTO player on the planet that would know this spot well enough to execute this strategy perfectly. But of course, Phil is no ordinary GTO player, and so he does indeed decide to shove. Fred quickly gets out of the way, and the decision is back to Doug with the second nuts. Now, Phil knows quite well that GTO players will make some really marginal bluff catches facing large bets to avoid being exploited. But what does GTO say when the bet size is so huge? Well, this is actually a pure fold, and the solver is only primarily calling with the nuts, and combos that have both showdown equity plus the ability to draw ahead with a full house or flush. However, this theory assumes your opponent is playing fundamentally sound poker. But what if your opponent is a muppet? Can Doug really fold the second nuts here? Thoroughly confused and visibly struggling with his decision, Doug proceeded to fall into a long tank, where he tried to channel the teachings of the man that taught him everything he knows about the game. The man the poker community writ large views as the greatest poker player of all time.
There I was, trying to determine the best way to teach poker strategy. And I'd written all this stuff down, and you know what? I ripped it all up and I threw it all away because it was no good teaching Texas Hold'em strategy without defining personalities. So I said, let me kind of describe the personalities, the types of people that you're liable to play against. And I said, let me further classify these players, these types, as animals. So I came up with five animals. First of all, the lion, who is the best player in the game. Our second animal, let's cut right to the jackal. The jackal is kind of that illogical, we call him in the poker world, a megalomaniac. We've seen a lot of jackals winning World Poker Tour tournaments. The eagle. What can you say about the eagle? He's one of the 50 or 100 top players in the world. Now, let's go to the mouse. The mouse is you right now. I'm teaching you to be a mouse. Why? Because in sitting there and playing really, really tight, I'm teaching you to be a mouse. You're not going to get hurt when you're a mouse. You get to sit at the table. You get to play a very, very tight strategy. The mouse is kind of like your old Aunt Edna. You know, she throws dollars around like manhole covers. Never bluffs, waits for very strong hands. Let's talk about yellow belt on the flop aggression. The power of the raise. Man, I love raising on the flop. Raise it. I like to find out where I stand with my top 10 hand. Find out where you are. Put the raises and the re-raises in. If a mouse bets out, you know what? I think you can just fold right then and there.
No, this is just a fold.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain